Hello and welcome everyone to our Kubernetes 101 webinar series. Since its open sourcing in 2016, Kubernetes has become the de facto standard for running applications in the cloud. In our series, we cover the theoretical and technical fundamentals of this technology to help you accelerate your cloud native journey. In our first part today, we take a step back and show you how to get started with containers. In case you have questions, please post them into the chat and we will answer them at the end of the presentation. And now I want to hand over to our trainer, Hubert.
Thanks, Chrissy, a lot for your introduction. Today is our first episode about containers of our webinar series called Kubernetes 101. So I want to spend a few words about myself. My name is Hubert. You can see my Twitter handle and my GitHub handle. I'm a consultant lotser. I was a software developer for about 12 years in the GVM universe, basically. But nowadays I do care a little bit more about Golang. 5 years ago, I switched towards the DevOps side of things. So in my last role, I was infrastructure architect and we switched from monolith to microservices. Deployed traditionally at the beginning, then we moved to Docker, then to Docker Compose, then to Docker Swarm. And in the end, we deployed our stuff on Kubernetes. I'm a certified Kubernetes administrator and a certified Kubernetes application developer. And I'm a Linux Foundation trainer for giving the courses to get certified. And I like to speak. I speak at conferences and meetups, and I organize a small conference, a small meetup in Linz, which is called Infrastructure as a Meetup. A few words about Lotse. Lotse was founded in 2016, and the headquarters are in Hamburg, Germany, Europe. We are a completely remote company, so we are spread across the globe. I have a lot of colleagues of Europe, for sure, but also from US and India. Lotse has a lot of expertise in containers and cloud native technologies. I will show you some products from Lotse in the next slide. We also do trainings and consulting, but we also do conferences, so the Go Days, and the container days are organized by Lotse. We have two products at Lotse, Kubematic and KubeOne. So Kubematic is about managing hundreds of Kubernetes clusters, no matter if they are run in AWS, Azure, GCP, Alibaba, or many other cloud providers. Or you can even run your clusters on premise, on bare metal. Kubematic will manage that for you and has a very smart way of upgrading your clusters, for example. KubeOne is about bootstrapping one Kubernetes cluster. Besides of our products, and by the way, a new product will come up soon, which will also be an open source product like KubeOne. We offer consulting and training. So we help our customers to get into the clouds and towards Kubernetes, for example, and we offer training. So the idea is to get our customers to run their clusters on their own. Yes, and we are certified for doing this for sure. So let's talk about containers. The agenda for today, we will start with the motivation of containers. Why do we talk at all about containers? I will bring up some definitions about terms you should know in the container world. We will dive into some live coding. Then we will talk a little bit about Docker Compose. And this will be basically a teaser to container orchestration at the end. So why containers? For this, I want to use my dashboard or whiteboard. So let's start with some traditional stack. So let's call this one traditional. So, we have some hardware for sure. And on top of this hardware, we install some operating system. And we have some LIPS. And on these machines, we install, for example, our Java applications, our Node applications. And those applications have dependencies to libraries, for example. But the libraries also need, for example, some specific operating system. And there are also dependencies to the hardware. And so we have a situation like this at the end. And the same is true for the Java application. And for sure, you can have more than two applications running on a machine. So what's the problem? Now I want to upgrade this Node application, and maybe this has some implications on the LIPS, and you can get into very dirty situations. So we should talk about VMs. Again, we have hardware. On top of the hardware, we have, for example, an operating system, and then we have something which is called hypervisor. On top of this hypervisor, we run VMs. And this is VM1 and VM2. And in this VM, we have a fully operating system. We again have some LIPS. And the Java application. So now it gets dirty. Again, we have an operating system and the LIPS and the Node applications. And for sure, we have dependencies. But now, if we want to upgrade, for example, the Node application, we only have to care about the dependencies of the Node application as long as we create the new VM image, for example. That's fine. Now we are talking about containers. So what's the difference? Again, we have some hardware and some operating system. But this time we don't have a hypervisor, we have a container runtime engine, like for example Docker. And on top on this container runtime engine, we have containers. And of course, you can have more than two containers. So this container one, this container two. We have some LIPS. We have some LIPS. And we have our Java application and our Node application. And for sure, we have dependencies. But upgrading stuff isn't that complicated anymore. You only have to create a new container image and run it. So this should also give you a simple picture about the resource usage. So containers lose less resources than VMs. So let me switch back. Slides. So what's the difference between VMs and containers concerning resources? Keep in mind, VMs host the whole operating system. So from the CPU's perspective, we are talking about cores. If you're talking about containers, can get down to millicores. When we are talking about memory, running a whole operating system is about gigabytes. In containers, we are talking about megabytes. For sure, you can also have bigger containers, but you can get down to a very small amounts of megabytes. Talking about the disk space, a whole operating system takes disk space, so we are talking about gigabytes. And in the container world, we are talking about megabytes. And this even goes further because the container world has a very smart caching mechanism. So you can reuse layers basically. and it's a very small footprint for the disk size. The boot up time, booting up an operating system normally takes minutes. In the container world, we are talking about seconds. But from the isolation points of view, VMs have a better isolation level than containers. Keep in mind, VMs are fully blown operating systems. Containers are in the end processes running on a single kernel. Another motivation for running containers is that this sentence is not valid anymore, so it works on my machine. If you use Docker, even in developing your stuff, you have the same runtime like in production or in testing or in staging or whatever. So it works on my machine should be a sentence from the past. One more thing I want to visualize for you. So I have to switch to the next one. If you have, for example, a Linux machine, so for example, Ubuntu, which contains a kernel, and install on top of that Docker as container runtime engine, you can run containers. You can run lots of containers. In this case, we say this one is an Ubuntu, so a container based on the Ubuntu image. The second one is based on Red Hat Enterprise Linux. And a question which I get often at the trainings is the following. Can I do this? Can I run a Windows container on a Linux machine? And the answer is no. Some of you may say, but I was running this Nginx based on Ubuntu on my Windows machine. Yeah, Windows did this via running a virtual machine in the background. So if you want to run a Linux container, you have to be on a Linux machine. And if you want to run a Windows container, you have to be on a Windows machine. Back to the slides. Now let's talk a little bit about the terminology. This is a definition which you hear a lot, which is not correct. It feels like containers are lightweight VMs, but that's no proper definition. This is a proper definition. So containers are processes born from tarballs anchored in namespaces controlled by C groups. What does that mean? Containers are processes. I already mentioned that containers are processes which share a single kernel born from tarballs. In the end, those layers of which an image consists are zip files, which you can download basically. Anchored in namespaces and controlled by C groups. There we have to talk about namespaces and C groups. What are namespaces and what are C groups? Namespaces are kernel features. Namespaces and C groups are kernel features. Namespaces allow you allow processes to see, for example, a specific file mount or some network interface or some processes. So a namespace shrinks the things a process can see. C groups is about resources. So I can say this process is allowed to take 1 gig memory and 1 core for processing stuff. And these are the building blocks for the whole container world, basically. How did we deploy stuff in the past? There was this one awesome ops guy, which did some manual work, but we had a big issue if this guy got sick or quit the company. So we started to do the following. We started to write documentation. Most of you know this install.txt or install.doc files, which are most of the time already outdated. So we did the next step. We wrote those documentation in the language even the machines can read, so install.sh or install.exe. So there we didn't have the issues that the stuff gets outdated because it has to be runnable. And Docker files are exactly the same. So Docker files are like this sh or exe files in a standardized way. So it's about how to deploy stuff. And therefore, I want to switch back to here. So, how do we do stuff with the Docker files? This is your machine, and you have written your executable, so your application. Then you write a Docker file, and we will take a look at this at the at the live coding section. We will do this live. So we write our Docker files, and based on this Docker file, we will build a Docker image, which has basically the same amount of layers like the lines of the Docker file, which is interesting. Based on the container image, on the image, we can run containers. We will do this in the live section. So based on the image, we will run containers, and we can run the even two containers of the same image if we want to. So this is the Docker file. This is the image. And these are containers. So next step. Now we want to share our containerized application with some other guy. So we will need something for this, which we call registry. And we can push our images to this registry, and the other guy then can pull those images. So the image is also here now, and he can run his containers like we did. So it's basically the workflow of working with Docker. So, as we have seen, an image is a template. Spoken in object-oriented terms, maybe it's something like a class. A container is an instance of that class, speaking in object-oriented terms. So the container is basically an instance of the image. An image consists of several layers, and each line of the Docker file will result in a layer. So this has some implications. It's important how you write your Docker files. The order of things is very important for keeping stuff small and getting your images faster. A container registry is an image repo. Most of you will know stuff like Maven or Artifactory, but for images. So you can get your images to run your containers. For sure, there are private registries and public registries. The most famous public registry is Docker Hub. Speaking of container runtimes, besides Docker, there are some alternatives. So Cryo and Rocket. Rocket, as far as I know, is not has been stopped by CoreOS, so this will not be finished anymore, as far as I know. Cryo was built for the Kubernetes world, so this we will see Cryo in the future. Yeah, currently most of the people work with Docker, that's fine. And stuff you write, your images which you write with Docker, you can also use with other container runtimes because they did some abstraction and some standardization, which is very good. So let's dive into live coding. Now you should see my IDE. So here you can see some terminal, and we have three folders. These are the exercises we will do now. So the first one is basically a Hello World example. Let's take a look at this Docker file. It's very basic. So the first line is from busybox 1.31.1. So here we define the base image. And this from line has to be the first line. Yes, you can write the comment in line one and then the from in the second line. But it should be the first instruction in the Docker file. So busybox is a very slim Linux container, and this is the version number. And it's important. It's also important, like in the software development world, to pin down your version numbers. It's also important in the container world. So in production, you have to write the version numbers of what things you use. Otherwise, it will get not that much fun to debug stuff. So entry point and comment. What is entry point? Entry point defines the process which will be started on starting the container. In this case, we start the executable echo. And with comment, we can define some default parameters. In this case, this will end in an echo hello world. And let's try this out, if this works outside the container too. So echo hello world. Oh, that looks nice. So let's containerize this. Let's make this a little bit bigger. We build an image with Docker build. We give the image a tag. So we have a nice name and a nice version number. For example, hello world, like this. Sorry, wrong folder. Yeah, you have to be in the right folder. So, and that was it. The image is built already. If we do Docker image ls, we'll see some images which are on my machine, but this one is the one we created. It's already 2 hours ago because I built it 2 hours ago, so it was taken from the cache basically. So let's run this Docker image. So we create an instance, which is in Docker terms a container. Docker run hello world, yeah, without any parameters. So we want the hello world image to get an instance or a container, and this should simply be run without any arguments. And it says also hello world. Awesome. So let's change the default arguments. So let's say hello Nitus 101. It works too. Awesome. So let's take a look at the containers which are running. No containers running. That's fine because the processes are already finished. So if you look at this, use all. We'll see that those two containers we started seconds ago are already finished. You see this in the status. Great. So let's switch to a more advanced example. Let you see here. So what do we have in this folder? We have some Go mod file and some Go web server script. So that's not of importance for us today. It's simply a web server, a Hello World web server, basically, which will print out a hello whatever to the browser. So we have no executable yet. So let's create the executable. So let go build. And hopefully we'll get executable. You can see it, it's here, it's called web server. Blah, blah, blah. So let's run this executable. We do this via this. And we open a second terminal and let's call this one. The web server expects traffic on port 8080 and the last part of the path is basically the hello message. So again, let's say, let's say container. Hello container, awesome. So the web server running in the container, no, sorry, not running the container yet. The web server running natively on our machine wrote hello container back. So now we put it into a container. Look at the Docker file. In this case, we use a Debian from the a space image. We copy the executable, which we created a second ago, into the container and define the process, which should be run like this with entry points. So let's build that stuff. So let's build it and we give it a proper tag. So now let's run this web server again in the container. In this case, we want to start it in the detached mode, which means the process is starting in the back and we do not have to open a new terminal. Due to the fact that this is a web application, we have to care about ports. Otherwise, we will not get any traffic towards our web server. And you do this via the minus P flag. And we say, use the 80 port of the host of my machine, bind it to 8080 of the container port. And then we can give the container a proper name and have to write the container, the image name. So let's do this. So due to the fact we started the container in a detached mode, it got started in the background. And we can do, for example, a curl localhost. Now in container, now it's right. Awesome. So this worked. A few words about stopping a container. Already mentioned with Docker PS, you see the running containers. And this web server is still running, so we see it in this list. Now we have three ways of stopping this container. The first way is Docker. And we could use the name of the container, which is web server, but we can also use the container ID, for example, 04, and that's enough. So we can, there's some convenience in the command line of Docker. So if we do a Docker stop, the container will be stopped. And if we do a curl, this will not work anymore, but we can restart stuff. And if we do a curl, now it works again. Great. This is the first way. There's a second way, Docker kill. Now, what's the difference between stop and kill? On stop, we send a seek turn signal to the process. So the application has some time to gracefully shut down. If we do a Docker kill, the application has no time to do a gracefully shutdown, the process will be killed. The time period for the graceful shutdown, you can customize for sure. The default is 30 seconds. So now I will show you even the third way, Docker minus F like this. If you do a Docker RM, everything gets stopped for sure and no graceful shutdown, and the container will be deleted, so you can't start it anymore. And if we integrate docker-ps now, there's no running container anymore. And if you do docker-ps, we only see the two container we started previously. Okay, so let's switch back to the slides. Oh, yeah, the demo gods very fast. Thanks. Let's talk about Docker Compose. Before we do a live coding with Docker Compose, we have to define what is imperative and what is declarative. So what we did the last minutes was imperative. So we knew some commands, some Docker commands, and we started containers. With Docker Compose, you have a declarative approach on doing things, which should be preferred. Let's discuss the difference between imperative and declarative first. In the imperative way, I say, I know how to do things and I do it, basically. The declarative way, I only know what I would like to have. So I do not know any Docker commands, basically. In imperative way, I have explicit instructions. In the declarative way, I only describe the outcome. And in other words, in the imperative way, the system is stupid and you are smart. In the declarative way, the system is smart and you don't care. So the declarative approach is preferable also in terms of infrastructure as code. You want to have that stuff in, for example, YAML files, which you then can commit to your Git repository, which brings us to another whiteboard drawing. So what we did now was that we are now on our machine, and there's some container runtime running. And with the Docker commands, we imperatively did the following. We started a container and another container. So let's make a different example. For example, this is a web server, and this is a database. And the web server wants to talk to the database. So you have to care about network. There's something which is called container networks too. And a database is most of the time stateful, and you should persist your data. One important note, containers are ephemeral. If you delete the container, everything is gone. So we have to find a way to make stuff persistent. And there's a concept which is called volumes. So let's create a folder on the host machine, which is called my volume, and the database can then use this. And they have to be connected with the network. And it even goes further. We have some 8080 port, which is bound to the port 80, so we can get traffic towards the container. You can do this imperatively, for sure. But what if? So create the file, which is called docker-compose.yaml, where we describe declaratively all the things, and we can check this in into Git, and we have version history and stuff like that. And this is basically Docker Compose. And let's take a look at it in live coding. So I switch back to here. So what do we have in this folder? We have some Prometheus YAML file, which you shouldn't care about. It's what I want to show you is how to bootstrap free containers with a Docker Compose file. We do this with a Prometheus time series database, a C advisor, which talks to the container runtime, and our web server. So this configuration file Oh, no, my mouse got lost. Great. Oh, no. So, this config file doesn't matter for you that much. Let's talk about the Docker Compose YAML file. So we have the service section, and in the service section, we defined three containers. The first one is Prometheus. It's a time series database. It's not that important for you right now. Then we have cAdvisor, which is the second container. It's not that important for you right now. And we have our web server, which we created a few minutes ago. So what's in such a container declaration? So for sure, this service has a name. The image has to be defined. The container gets a name. Then we define these volumes. I already mentioned that you want to make stuff persistent. In this case, it's a configuration file, which we then can pass to the process. And we define which ports get bound to which port. Important, it's always at first the host port, and the second number is the container port. cAdvisor looks very similar. We have a bunch of volumes here and also some port, and our web server can look like this. So let's try this. There's now another command. Let's see. And hopefully stuff gets, yeah. So let's take a look. It's running since 3 seconds. So let's open this, like this. So let's curl our web server, which is running on but 8081. Works. Let's take a look at the cAdvisor, which offers some metrics which can be scraped from the Prometheus server. A lot of metrics. Awesome. So now we look in the Prometheus via the browser, which is run on localhost on port 80. So this is enough. And then I have to take a look at my cheat sheet. I don't know, this one. That's a Prometheus query. I prefer. So let's visualize that stuff and make the increase a little. So what you see here is you get, with Prometheus, you get a very fast feedback about your containers. So there are three lines. So the first one is the cAdvisor memory usage. The second one is the Prometheus memory usage. And the third one is the web server memory usage, which is not of importance for this. But I wanted to show you it's really not that complicated to bootstrap a lot of containers. Today we are talking about three containers, but you can run hundreds of containers for sure with Docker Compose if your machine is big enough. So great, then switch back to the slides, I think. Yeah, DemoGod was with us. Container orchestration, so which is the last point. Therefore, I want to visualize again something. So what we did with Docker Compose was the following. We created a machine, and there was some magic file, which was the Docker Compose YAML file. And in the container runtime, some containers were started. But what if we want to have more than one machines? In this example, now we have three machines, but you can have clusters of machines with 5,000 nodes. So you can do this with Docker Compose, but it doesn't make that much fun, I think. We need something bigger. And that's where we speak about container orchestration. Most of you now have a lot of concerns because there are a lot of other topics which have to be covered, for example, scheduling, who decides which container gets started on what machine, lifecycle and health. Is there somebody which cares about restarting my container if he has an issue? scaling. If you want to scale out your web server from 1 to 7 instances, you even can do this in an automated way in Kubernetes. The whole networking stuff gets even more complicated. So you need some kind of network which all nodes are in. And you don't want to write some IP addresses. You maybe want to have some nice DNS names. So also some DNS server would be awesome. And if you scale out, basically, you have to care about load balancing. And one thing we didn't discuss in this picture was storage. Where can I put my persistence stuff in here? And there are a lot of other topics like logging, monitoring, debugging, introspection, stuff like this, which will be covered in the future webinars. And I give back to Chrissy. And if there are some questions, it would be great to answer them.
Yeah, thank you, Hubert. And thank you, everyone, for being so active in our chat. That's really nice. The first question that I have is that is there really no limit besides RAM and CPU resources on the host regarding the number of Docker containers?
No, if you run out of resources, this will be your first concern. So you can run hundreds of containers for sure. Yeah.
Then we have another question. Is the from Debian 1.12 directive specifying an OS above which a container is built? And then Roland Chessy already answered, yes, this defines the image on which you want to base your image.
Yeah, exactly.
Do you have anything to add, Hubert? Okay.
Yeah, great question, great answer. Yeah, you define, you pin down the exact version and you can base your images on an own base image, basically, which I see a lot in companies. So you can write your own base image with your proper operating system and stuff like that, which then can be used by your colleagues. Yeah.
All right. Are there any more questions? No, does not seem like. Then I thank you very much for joining our very first webinar. As said, feedback is very much appreciated. So just write me an email on marketing@lotse.com if you want to like suggest the topic or provide feedback. We would be happy to see you again for our second part, Introduction to Kubernetes, which will take place on April 28, again at 5 p.m. And you will receive an invite to the next session and also the recording of today's session in the following days. I thank you very much and wish you a nice day. Oh, sorry, one last question. Can we use Docker Compose with a custom ingress controller?
Ingress controllers are apart from the Kubernetes world. To be honest, I haven't seen somebody using ingress controllers in the Compose world. I would be interested to be honest. So I can't really answer this question because I haven't seen that yet. I'm a little bit surprised about the combination, to be honest.
All right. The last question from Ola, are we going to see it on YouTube? Yes, we do have a YouTube channel. We'll add it in the coming days, and you will also receive an email including the recording. Anything else? All right, then we stick very precisely to the 45 minutes. Thank you again. And hope to see you again. Have a nice day.
Bye.